two, standing go. By.
You're listening to and possibly watching the Comic Book Bears podcast. I'm Bill Zanowitz.
I'm Steve Morey.
And I'm Caleb Alexander McKenzie.
And we are your hairy, heavy homos that talk about comic books, but you don't have to be a hairy, heavy homo to listen in. You okay there?
I got lost in Magneto's helmet.
I was going to say.
It's a big helmet.
I didn't get a refit.
That's what he said.
Yeah.
It's a well endowed helmet.
I understood that reference. Okay. So we're back with you after a few weeks away. I know the last audio episode that we released was on January 3rd, so it doesn't seem like that long, but it's been, 4 weeks, I think?
Yeah.
Yeah. And we've
all. Our last episode was was Aquaman, too.
Right. Yeah. And we didn't even have Caleb during that episode because
I was in Dallas, I think.
Why don't we just go around and say what everybody's been up to?
Well, Bill, did you want to go first, or we could go
first? Since mine's the most boring, yeah, I went to Philadelphia for work.
The city of brotherly love. Come on.
I will say this. I've only done this a few times in my life, and I'm not talking like New Jersey Transit trains. I'm talking like an actual. Like Amtrak or sell a train. Have you guys ever taken a train at night?
Yeah.
Only like a city train, not like
but like a real, like you said,
yeah.
Steve, there's a sexiness about it.
There kind of is. And also kind of like eerie too.
It doesn't feel like you're in America for like a few split seconds.
Yeah.
You know, it feels very European, or at least that's just what I have in my head. Like, you know, like either David Bowie or the Walker Brothers playing, you know, something. That was a good part of the show, but we had a team building exercise in Philadelphia, so we were able to go over after MLK Day. These people that I've been working with since beginning of December, I finally met them in person. Only three or four people out of a team of 38 that I've met before in person. So it was a nice little excursion. In terms of work stuff, but it was still a work trip. So, you know, how much fun are you going to have? That's what I did. You guys did much more interesting stuff on our break.
I don't know. Was it that interesting? In January, for the first half, for the first couple of weeks, I did nothing other than work. And then the hubby and I went down to the Bahamas, which was great. So we missed almost all of like the deep Arctic freeze that came through. And, you know, it was just awful throughout the country. And I think Caleb might mention something about that. We had a really great time. We were staying with friends. So we weren't at a hotel or anything. We were just right on the beach. Got to have some great food because one of our friends, John, is an amazing cook. So he made dinner for us pretty much every night. And we just got to just experience the sun, the sand. And my Kindle was my best friend. I read a lot of books, but not so much comics. I did read a couple graphic novels. Did actually finally get the graphic novel adaptation of Wool, which was great. That was by Jimmy Palmiotti. But the rest of it was just prose books. I don't know why I did this.
For those of you who are listening at home, Bill's shaking his head like, what are you doing? So we actually had a very interesting conversation about this, which will play into some of the stuff I did too. But Steve and I both have something in common. When we go on vacations, I mean, arguably depending on the vacation, right? But like if we're going to a beach setting, if there's going to be a lot of like sand and water situation, we both take veritable libraries with us, right? Like that is an amazing beach vacation for me. I want to sit my butt in the sand at sunrise with a giant cup of Coke and rum and not move and just read till the sun goes back down. That is my perfect beach vacation. Bill does not read on vacation.
No.
he does not understand this concept.
I will listen to stuff, but it's too close to work for me.
Yeah.
I think that's why. And I'd much rather spend the time, if you were going to be spending time reading, I'd rather go to local shops. I'd rather go explore. That's just the way I'm wired. I wouldn't waste a location on reading. I know you really, like, I might read at the Jersey Shore because I've been there a thousand fucking times. Right. But when it's when it's a vacation destination, that's nothing I would do. I would bring reading material with me for like the airport and stuff like that.
Right.
But that's nothing I'd do.
So if I'm going to the beach, if I'm going somewhere down the Gulf Coast, because Arkansas, closest beach really is Gulf Coast. Like everything is just souvenir shops, right? Like it's all just mass produced crap that if you've seen it once, you've seen it all the time. Like there's only so many fake shark teeth in a bottle I can look at. But
shot glasses,
a few months ago when I went to Chicago, right? Like, did I take stuff to read? Sure. But I didn't read anything while I was there. I walked around, met Wendy for lunch, hung out with people, met our friend Asha. And so it really depends for me on the setting. Like if I'm going to a really urban area, especially in an urban area that I'm not from, like I'm going to pull a Bill, right? I'm just going to go I'm going to get a buzz going and then just go walk around the city. It's my favorite thing.
Yeah. I might buy 1,000 books on that trip.
Right. Yeah.
But I won't read them.
Yeah. Yeah. See, for me, it was just, beautiful setting. It was being able to read in such a beautiful setting. Like I went out into the ocean every day, which Jason was like shocked at me because usually when I'm at the beach, I don't even bother with the water, but I was out there every day in the water doing we walked, we basically had a private beach. It was awesome. Just walking, and floating around, swimming. It was fun. But then afterwards, I'd come back. We'd warm ourselves on the patio. I'd have my Kindle with me. Or, if it got super hot and sunny during the day and need to be inside, I'd read the Kindle. Like, it was good. I got a lot of reading done. It was nice.
Nice.
But then I came back.
So it's always the worst part of vacation. Yeah. So right before Christmas, it was right after Christmas, the day after Christmas. Roger and I jumped in the car and we drove to Dallas for a week. I love Dallas. For those of you who know me, I'm a huge football fan. And so I'm Dallas Cowboys. It's my team, much to Bill's chagrin. He likes to, Bill's team put me out this year.
But I have not rubbed it in.
You have not. You have been very gracious.
That way.
Yeah.
I hate people like that.
Yeah.
Saying it for at least 7 days before it happened. Of any given Sunday, which in the postseason can also be any given Saturday for me
or Friday.
But I am not one of those people. I've never understood that. Yeah, there's teams I kind of hate, but very often it's like for rationales that go beyond sports, whether it's like team ownership or a really impulsive fan base.
Yeah.
See also Patriots and especially the Eagles.
Yeah.
The Eagles, I will never, ever, ever, ever go to another game, another home game, Eagles home game.
It's crazy.
They will agree with each other and beat the shit out of each other. It's insane. It's insane. Unless it was like a luxury box situation and I was like cool with every person in that luxury box, never doing that again, ever. Yeah,
that's all my family, by the way.
Caleb had a first, so this is
While we were there, I got to attend my first Cowboys game. I've never been to an NFL game before that. Was at the notorious Cowboys Lions game, right, where the botched call at the end, and then the botched play calls at the end, and all the stuff. Right, it was all my fault because I was there. So that happened. And what was funny is everybody at home knew what was going on because you can hear the commentary, right? Like the people on TV are like talking. You don't get that when you're standing. And also, especially not when you're in the part of the stands that we can afford. Like, we're not down near the field. We don't roll like that. But like we had great high seats where you could see everything, but you don't hear what's going on, right? So we're all just like, yeah, the Cowboys won, but none of us know why. Like, we're like, what happened? And so it was leaving there. Like, I immediately just flipped over to satellite radio to the sports, the NFL channel to figure out why my team won. Cause I didn't know. I was happy. And so caught up on all the drama. My husband's birthday is December 27th. And so we kicked it in there for his birthday, had a really great time, came back, New Year's with friends. After that, had a big work convention here in Little Rock, gave a pretty good presentation in front of about 1,500 people, which was really nice. It went really well. And then after that, the winter apocalypse hit Arkansas. We got that big Arctic blast that rolled down. Lots of snow, single digits for a few days. I work, you know, as a volunteer with the unsheltered population here with a group called The Van. And whenever it drops below freezing, if there's winter precipitation or it's below 25 degrees, we open up emergency shelters. And so our team and I did 12-hour shifts. I ran nights. Aaron, the day folks, did his thing. So for about 4 days, just, you know, did that. So it's about all you can do. So I'm very glad it's above freezing. I never want it to be below 33 degrees again. That would suit me just fine.
All right. So we're going to just, Steve can just relax for a second, maybe read if he wants to. But for a minute, Caleb and I are going to get into football for 1 minute here.
Ooh, yeah.
And I'm going to provide the Super Bowl scenarios and you tell me who you are rooting for in that situation.
Okay.
Can I show the graphic that I had prepared for this?
Please do. I didn't know you had one, but go ahead.
Sneaky Steve.
It's just a graphic.
I guess. Go ahead there.
It's been popularized over the past week since. I'm gonna put it up here because it fits with our.
Now I get it. Yeah. Okay. There we go.
Yes. You know what's funny? Everybody's talking about this because Kelsey, it's Jason Kelsey for those who are listening, right? Shirtless at his brother's game, the Kansas City game against where they Kansas City beat Buffalo. But everybody's talking about the fact that he's shirtless for good reason. It's a nice view, right? No one's really mentioned the fact that Jason Kelsey was wearing sweatpants inside a box seat to his brother's game. That's what I find fascinating. Like,
if you notice the footage when he came in, because if you've seen the footage where he's taking the shot out of the bowling ball with Bill's Mafia in the parking lot, he was in sweatpants then.
I love that he's just like, he's in sweatpants. Like, yeah. No one's talking about that. It's awesome.
The other thing that I think people are going to be discovering is just how good a podcast host he is.
Yeah.
And there's going to be, I think, some very big offers coming this way for commentary.
I would love him and Tony Romo to call a game together.
I don't think you'll ever even get two players to call a game together. I don't think
that would be so good.
Yeah.
Those two would just geek out.
Yeah. But I don't think you'll ever see that. I would love to see him take over Tony Gungy's spot.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cause I hate that guy. And I think it's justified. He's a homophobic piece of shit who probably killed his own son, but allegedly. All right. So, let's go over to, who we will be rooting for if this is the scenario. If it is the Chiefs versus the Lions.
Lions.
I'll be rooting for the Chiefs.
Okay.
If it is the Chiefs versus the 49ers.
49ers.
I'll be rooting for the Chiefs. If it is the Ravens against the Lions.
Ooh, that's tough. Ravens.
Guess who I'm saying?
Ravens?
Lions.
Lions? Okay. Yeah. I'm cool either way with that one. I genuinely am cool either way with that one.
Yeah. It's still, though it's a rivalry, it's still the NFC North.
Yeah.
And theirs is a great story this year.
Yeah, it really is. No,
it really is. So
yeah, it is a wonderful story. And like I said, in that situation, I'm cool either way. The only reason I pick Lions is because Lamar Jackson was my fantasy quarterback this year for most of the season in my fantasy league, and I won that motherfucker. So I'm going to, like, appreciate it, bro. So
I don't do fantasy anymore because you end up rooting for situations that in real life make you so distasteful. At one point on the trade, I got Brian Urlacher. Yeah, I mean, can you imagine what that week was like for me until I got
how many hours of therapy did that get you?
So bad. All right, and then lastly, the Ravens versus the 49ers.
49ers.
Ravens. Yep. We don't agree on anything.
Nope.
Pretty fantastic.
I want to know, so we actually talked about this a little bit offline, but we didn't get too far into it. I have reasons for why, right? And I know you do as well. What are your reasons based off of?
The Chiefs have always been one of my backup teams.
Okay.
Along with the Steelers and the Giants. So those are teams that I can root for even during the regular season, given the right circumstances. So those have always been my three backup teams. So that's a good reason why the Chiefs are there.
Okay.
In terms of the Lions, like I said, it's a great story. I think per team member, I think the Ravens are actually the best team that's in the postseason. I don't think they're going to necessarily be triumphant even this week, but I do think the Ravens, player for player, are the best team out there. That doesn't mean they're going to win.
Yeah.
With the 49ers, they've just taken the Packers out too many times in the playoffs. You know, I got a chip on my shoulder, and I think it's justified.
That's fair.
Yeah.
That's fair. So I take a different approach to the playoffs, right? Season's different. My approach to playoffs, number one, I'm always going to root for the whoever the NFC team is, right? If the NFC wins, that means my conference is better than the other conference, right? So if an NFC team wins, all of the NFC teams get some sense of bragging, right? Like AFC lost, right? I'm always going to root for a team that, quite frankly, if it's the team that put the Cowboys out of the playoffs, I then want that team to win because it's better to get knocked out by the team that won the championship by the team that didn't make it. We got knocked out. So, and here's some other reasons for that. Like 49ers beat the ever-loving dog crap out of the Cowboys this year, right? I would love to be able to say, yes, they beat the crap out of us, but they were also the world champions, as opposed to, yeah, they beat the crap out of us, but also they didn't win. Like they were subpar, right? Like we lost to a lesser team. I'd love to be able to say that. Green Bay put Packers out or put the Cowboys out. I would like to be able to say, yes, Green Bay put us out, but they're the only team that actually gave the 49ers a run for their money, right? That's how good they were. It took the second best team to knock us out, right? There's some sense, like you want to be able to make the best argument that your team has a higher rank than maybe what they showed. So I'm always going to do that. And I was that way in high school, when I played football. I really wanted the team that put us out of the running to win. I was like, I'd love to be able to say, hey, yeah, we got knocked out, but we got knocked out by the same people that knocked everybody else out. So that's the way I approach it. So, I mean, and even to the point, I've cheered for Philly. Like I wanted Philly to beat Kansas City in 2023. Just, I want the NFC team to win. A rising tide lifts all ships. And that's the way I look at it. Except for Washington. Fuck those guys.
So Washington is the exception to your
libertarian paradise. I think so. I think so. Yeah. I think so.
I just want the prettiest people to win.
I may have done a slip up because I've had a friend for 30 years, Laura Gungy. I may have said Tony Gungy instead of Tony Dungy. I'm sorry if that happened. The case I do know better, but he gets me riled up. So
my husband's in the other room letting me know that he wants me to announce that he just wants Taylor Swift's team to win. That's the extent that he's team Tay Tay.
Okay.
Just a quick interjection here. David Hazan has joined us. Hello, David.
Hello.
Hey, boys, he says.
Sorry for the football talk. happens in
good old thing. American football.
So let's turn this around and let's talk about some comic books. I'm going to start with Caleb because he has a DC book that I'm not caught up on, but I do have every issue but one and will get caught up on. So why don't you talk about that first book?
Yeah, so the book in its entirety that I got to catch up on read is issues 1 through 10 of Superman Lost. This is, I loved this book. I really, really did. It was fantastic. this is kind of a closed universe thing. It doesn't play into the overall universe, but it could, right? There's nothing about it that really sets it up differently. But the reason I picked this up, number one, is because the creative team just grabbed my eye. This is he's just going by Priest in this, but it's Christopher Priest. And you know, if you didn't know that, you would tell that by the format, because it's very much his calling card. But not only is it Christopher Priest, it's also Carlo Pagulian. And that man has, you know, a longtime Hulk fan. He means a lot to me. So I was like, okay, Dream Team, I've got to pick this up and just see what they're doing in this. I read the first issue, and Bill, I think I was talking to you about this when I said that in one issue, Christopher Priest told a better Justice League story than he did in his entire Justice League run. And that is...
I would agree with that.
Yeah, it was phenomenal. It is a great single issue Justice League story, but it really plays into, you know, the overall plot. But he gets everybody. And by the way, Carlo Pagulian's Wonder Woman is just outstanding. She is gorgeous, fearsome, strong. I love seeing her. This was inked. I've never seen this inker on Carlo's work before, but Jason Paz, and I could be, and maybe I just didn't catch on to it. One of the better inkers I've seen on Carlo's work. And then Jeremy Cox did the colors with Willie Schubert on letters. So this book, like I said, I'm not going to sit here and talk about 10 issues worth of stuff. We're not going to be here till 4 a.m. But the long and short of it is, it's an average day, right? Lois is working on a story. She's trying to crack it. There's something, somebody's weird in local politics that she's really digging into. She knows there's something there. You know, Clark is letting her do her thing, right? Like he knows that she needs to do her work. And he's just like, well, you know, we can go to bed. And they're like, well, you know, we could go to bed or we can go to bed. And they're like, well, you know, if we do the one, as soon as it gets good, like my phone's going to ring or your phone's going to ring and we're going to have problems. And she's like, yeah, well, let me just finish this up. Lo and behold, it happens, right? Like Superman's beeper goes off and there's trouble in the world. He's got to go be Superman. And he flies off. Well, you know, Lois is used to this. This is standard fare for her. She's used to her husband running off into the night or the day or the whenever to be Superman, because he's Superman. And so she doesn't think anything of it. She's just going to keep working on her story. She's going to figure things out. And a few hours later, you know, time passes. Clark comes back in. Except Clark is stoic. Like he's not talking. He's just got this dead blank stare. And she's just like, what's up? What happened? He was just like, you know, you're you. And she's like, well, yeah, like you've only been gone for a few hours. And he's like, no, Lois, I've been gone for 20 years. And about that time, the doorbell rings and it's Bruce. And Bruce walks in and is like, Lois, I'm sorry. And Bruce knows that something's going on. And this is about the point Lois needs explanations, right? Something has happened here. What happened, right? The Justice League gets called out, and they're going out into the equivalent of the South China Sea. It's supposed to be international waters, but it's really not. Apparently, a submarine has sunk, nuclear missiles, right? Everything's bad. They got to go figure this out and do Justice League thing. Except when they get down there. And also, by the way, Christopher Priest writes amazing Aquaman. Like, I loved his Aquaman. This was a fun Aquaman. I'd read that story. They get down to the ocean floor and they're getting ready to do all the things they need to do. And they realize, well, this isn't a submarine. This isn't a Chinese sub. Like, this is like, what's going on here? It's an alien spacecraft. And inside this alien spacecraft, there is a singularity bomb that's about to go off. They don't know what, you know, at this point in time, we don't know who these folks are, what happened, but basically a black hole is about to open up and swallow existence as we know it, right? The only thing that can hold it together is Superman doing some really cool Superman stuff, right? Being selfless, being extremely strong, being able to like change the frequency that he operates at. And the Justice League all support this. And the whole idea is that, hey, we're going to tie Diana's lasso of truth around him, shove him off in there. He's going to fix this and we're going to get him out right before anything happens, right? Doesn't work out like that. Shoots Clark off into space and time. And that's kind of what happens. And he has to go on these adventures. And through the books, he goes to different planets, but it's so far away from the universe that even the Justice League is not the Justice League there, right? Like there's, there, there, not the Justice League, the Green Lantern Corps is nowhere to be found. They can't tap into this. They're there, right? There's elements of it there, but it's not the Green Lantern Corps that we know, right? Clark is bound and determined to get home to his family. But in the meantime, he also can't turn a blind eye to some really terrible situations on some of these planets, these unexplored, unmarked planets. He's Superman, right? His empathy and his compassion and everything that makes him him, it doesn't just exist in the Milky Way, right? It's not just in our universe. So he has to be Superman. And that comes at some pretty great sacrifices. Again, I don't want to spoil anything because I know Bill hasn't completely read it. Other folks might as well. I don't like time travel stories. This is an amazing time travel story. They do a really good job with it. They do a really good job understanding how space and time works and breaking it down and delivering it in a sense that a comic book can, right? I can understand this. I'm not a physicist. I get this. I get how it's supposed to work. It really plays into the selflessness of who Kal-El is. And what he will do to keep his word. You get to see the lengths that he will go to lift people up. And you get to see the spirit that he is infectious, right? Like his spirit is infectious among people. He forms a team. He has some people that he cooperates with. He's betrayed. There's lots of stuff happening here, but ultimately speaking, in a way, he gets home, but not without a whole lot of self-sacrifice. And so I'll leave it at that. Mm-hmm. Beautiful, beautiful book. Brilliantly drawn. The action sequences are wonderful. And there were moments in this where you just get a little misty-eyed. Like, this is the Superman that I love, right? This is wonderfully done. So if you have not read this, again, it's a 10-issue miniseries. All of the issues are out right now. I'm sure the trade is coming out. I think you can probably read it on the DC apps or whatever. Go check this out. This is the best Carlo Pagulian has looked in years. And forgive me if I'm mispronouncing his name, but it's the best he's looked in years. And he's always looked good, but this is stunning, stunning work. So already kind of in the running for, like, I've got a little check mark by it. This may be on my, like, best books of the year next year for 2024, which I count because, yes, only one issue came out in 24, but it finished in 2024. So I'm going to count. So
trade's coming up.
Yeah, I love it. I love this book. I love Tom Taylor's work on Superman. Don't get me wrong. This is one of the better Superman stories I've read in the last 4 or 5 years.
Steve, can you put the last graphic you had back up there? And oh, you know, sure, this was something that you touched on. And when I talked about issue one when it first came out and was just blown away by it. So, I mean, this cover tells you everything you need to know. And this is one of the frustrations of being a bit of a skinflint and always getting like the main cover and not the variant. This is just, I mean, it tells you everything you need to know. I mean, he's in a safe space. The Kents are literally looking over him.
Yeah.
But you can tell this is a guy who's been through some shit. And I just think this is just a stunning cover. I have up to issues 9, 10 will be in my next box. I did peek, through some stuff and I saw like the white costume and some other stuff. I did see an issue 9 because I didn't want to read it. I just wanted to finger through it. Let's say flip through it. Finger through it sounds,
you know, I was gonna let it go. Sorry about that.
But I did see that Dan Juergens did some of the pages on issue 9. Were there other interludes where there were other artists that came in through those?
I think there were a few. I know that in one of the story, Louis Prado did some work on it. Get Dan Breeding's inking Juergens at one point. I want to say that, Lee Weeks did a little bit. He's in there as well with that crew. You know, he brought the person who colors for him, Betty Brettweiser, in with him too, which I'm always kind of like on, but that's just me. But yeah, you get some of these interludes, and Bill, I'm glad you brought this up because at its heart, like you're seeing multiple parts of, you know, you're seeing where he went and where he is now. Ultimately, this is a PTSD story. And typically, if you look at me and say, hey, who's writing the best PTSD stories right now? I'd probably say Tom King. Tom King writes a lot of this internalized, just, you know, let's deal with mental health issues that stem from trauma, right? He's really good at that. most of this story, like when he's living with Lois for like a month and trying to get back to reality and just can't break it. And there's something there. And a lot of that stems from the fact that he's got unfinished business and Lois knows it. And she wants her husband back, but she knows that she can't get that back truly until he goes and figures things out. Cool. The white suit is amazing. Like that is a great conceit.
I have also heard that apart from the Superman elements in the story, I've also heard that Priest nails Lois and Lex Luthor.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yep. Okay. His Lex is just nasty, right? Like, but it's not an anti-hero way, but like Lex, if anybody gets to kill Clark, it's Lex, and no one else gets to do that. That's basically it in a nutshell, right? It's good. Lois is, she's just staunch. She's unwavable, which is exactly what you want from her. And they put Clark in a great position, which we've seen other writers do. Like, he's not near a yellow sun, which is where that kind of white suit comes in. Mm-hmm. And he's trying to travel through space. Also, if you're a fan of Lobo, I will say that there's one element of this book. There's one double page spread that will just make you smile, and Lobo's not in it, but you'll know what it is when you see it.
Okay, cool. All right. I'm going to stick with the House of L here. Sort of.
Well,
hey Edwin, how you
really,
doing?
Really quick. Yeah. Edwin De La Cruz joined us. I love the Superman story, Bill. So yeah, I think we've got several fans.
I will get to it. Here. I swear. Believe me, if I'm going to get to these boxes that I have here, Superman's going to be part of it. Don't worry about that. Hey, John, how you doing?
John Westhoff joined us, throwing up some horns. And then finally,
Doom fame. Hello, James.
Doom. And James Figueredo, good evening, you handsome gents. Good
favorite
evening,
Brazilian. James. Very happy to have them all with us tonight. So I want to talk about another book within the Superman family, sort of. And this is Kneel Before Zod, number one. This is the first ever extended solo story involving General Zod. You have to think, because of the prominence in the Donner films, you know, apart from Luthor, he's probably the best known Superman villain. I don't think in the popular conscious that Brainiac has
I was gonna say Brainiac would be the third one on that list, but
with General Zod, if you've been following where things stand in DC Comics, there's a sort of detente that's operating right now between him and Superman, and Zod as participating in the what is that, League of Planets? I forget. United Planets. Is it United Planets?
I think it's the United Planets, yeah.
Something like that. Whatever the Legion had, it's been updated, it's been pushed up in time to the current DC universe. And he is participating with them to bring order into the galaxy. He has a planet of his own now. He's conquered a planet. He's named it New Kandor. He's in possession of Kandor from the bottled city that Brainiac had created. And eventually his plan is to populate this new world with the revived Kandorians that are in the bottle. And it's effectively going to be a new Krypton. But he's Zod. He's not a leader of men in a political sense, he's a leader of men in a war sense. So he's in some territory that is fairly unfamiliar to him, and it's taxing his mind. We actually start with a argument between him and Jor-El. We all know Jor-El is long dead, but in his head he's alive. So you have to question, you know, where exactly is Zod at this point? And is he the best decision maker? So there's a lot of things that are going on in this planet where they're doing bioengineering. There's robotics. He is intent on reviving some form of Krypton on this planet that is New Kandor. He's also, as we said, a warrior, and with warrior comes conquest. He's building a weapon on this planet, and it probably will be the functional equivalent of a Warworld or a Death Star. It's going to be a very powerful weapon. Now, if you know what's going on with Zod, there's a Zod family. He has married Ursa, and he has a son, Drew. Is it Drew Zod? Yeah, Drew Zod. No, he's Drew Zod, Lar Zod. Sorry about that. And the son is about as appealing as Damian is. He's suspect. He's conniving. He wants to get ahead. He is very dedicated to his father in his own way, but they're not seeing eye to eye. And Lar Zod discovers this weapon and realizes that his father has been sort of deceiving him, calls him on it, and Zod puts him in his place in seconds and eventually bans his own son from the planet, sends him off into the universe. There's no place for him here. He doesn't work into my plans. When you talked about Caleb, when you talked about like a well-written Luther and how it's effectively a character that there's so much color to him, to just apply villain to the character doesn't do the character justice. And the interpretation of Zod here is very much along those lines. Now, again, we said, you know, he's participating with the United Planets. So there's, you know, notoriety that there is this new planet, and who comes to try to conquer them, but the Kuns. And Zod wipes out a battalion of Kuns himself. And it's a great, great action sequence. Perfect action sequence that leads into what effectively is the first cliffhanger at the end of the first issue. The artist on this, not the artist on this cover, but the artist is someone, Dan McDade, who I haven't seen. I haven't seen his work for some time, though he has been very active, just not on properties that I regularly read, like especially the books coming out from Titan of Doctor Who. And it just like scares me that this was already like 14, 15 years ago at this point. He was the artist on a series, Jersey Gods, if you remember that came out of Image, that effectively was, okay, what if Orion of the New Gods fell in love with this chick from New Jersey? That basically was the series, and it was great. And his art style worked beautifully for that. Bordering on cartoony, but you know, in that way that you still buy it as very superhero action. You know, I think Ed McGuinness is like a fairly good comparison.
Okay.
And it works better than I thought it would when I saw that his name was attached to it, because McDade's work, you know, tends to be, you know, very bright colors. There's like a vibrancy to it. So when you're telling a story of somebody who's steeped in war and conquest, I didn't know how well that would adapt, but he's perfect on this. The writer is Joe Casey. Back in the early 2000s, Joe Casey wrote a ton of great Superman stories. And that certainly is a welcome addition to that canon. I also wanted to just mention that if you're a regular reader of Action Comics, in issue 1060, there is a short prologue with the same team, which basically sets us up. You don't necessarily need to read this to get whatever you're going to get out of Neil Before Zod number one, but it's a nice little supplement. That's something I recommend. I believe this is set for 5 issues, unless it sells better than they expect. Neil Before Zod number one from DC, again by Joe Casey and Dan McDade.
Yep, and I think you've convinced Edwin to pick this one up as well.
Yeah, Edwin, I think you really, I think you really like to
read
it.
This.
Yep.
Yeah,
and I love stories from the extended Superman universe. When they're not done well, it's a slog. But when they are done well, it's up there in terms of enjoyable comic book reading experiences.
I'm really surprised that there hasn't been sort of like a mini series or, you know, a book.
Yeah.
Starring Zod, like all the stuff. Cause I mean, you know, this,
and I also think 70s, you know, where he is right now, you know, he's already had conflict with the Green Lantern Corps. Where he is now, that opens him up to, and Lobo's not in it. that opens him up to, you know, the other spaceborn kind of, like, you know, he could be, you know, facing Adam Strange or the Omega Men or the New Gods. You know, there's a lot of different possibilities in terms of the, you know, him being effectively a space character now. And a lot of ways that you can interpret this character, you know, whether it be from a societal or political, because, you know, some of his arguments can be supported. If you were from a dead culture, you'd want to see it revived. And, you know, the methods may be something totally alien and distasteful to you, but the argument is one that can be made and one that can be understood and one that can be sympathized and God forbid empathized. And there's a lot of texture that you can play with this character. And plus he's hot too.
Yeah. There's a lot of overlap between him and characters. I mean, characters like Magneto, right? Even Namor to an extent. There's a lot of overlap with there as far as they're doing the wrong thing, but the there's a good reason behind it. You can't. I mean, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of shared space in that diagram.
Yeah. Yeah. So except for the whole genocide thing.
Well, right, but I mean. If you could resurrect, like Bill said, though, if you can resurrect your culture and your family, you know, what wouldn't you do to get your family back?
Yeah.
Right.
And that's the thing. I wouldn't necessarily think Superman is a Nazi. Think of Superman as General Patton.
Right.
In some ways, that's just as scary, if not scarier. So.
Well, and with Zod as well, I think probably where he's been limited up to this point is that he's, you know, Earth is the prize. And I think Earth is always the prize. I mean, that's just sort of the conceit of the whole DC universe, that there's something about Earth, you know, and Earth Prime. But, you know, putting him out in the universe, there's plenty of planets out there for him to revive his culture on. Some that might be better suited than, you know, one that already has 7 billion people on it with a whole bunch of their own problems. You know, he could start from scratch, and that, you know, having him get that opportunity to go, you know, Sinestro on a planet, I guess would be, you know, is a good.
There was one way thing to, I to never really it, I thought about that they address in that brief beginning here, where it's this weird conversation with Dream Jor-El and him, this weird argument, was that Krypton cast him out.
Yeah.
You know, they squashed his insurrection. It was Krypton that did it. It wasn't just Jor-El. It was the society.
Yeah.
So that adds another layer of complication of, you know, hey, they turned your back on you. Why are you like this? So like you said, there's no straight line with this character. It's a bunch of waves.
Right.
And
it's funny that you bring that up, because there, like in Superman Lost, there's a kind of a thread of that and some of the places that he goes, there's almost this libertarian aspect where the people are going to vote the way they vote no matter what, and we respect that, right? And we're going to, even if it's terrible, right? And so there's kind of that similar byline in that thread that I find interesting as far as the what that means to the Superman universe and to all the characters that spin out of it, and what those seeds where those roots dig into those characters. So that is a very interesting thing.
Yep. Okay, on to Steve. Steve, I understand you have two books you want to talk about, and you're going to be talking about them at the same time?
Yes, because they do fit very well together.
Okay.
And interestingly enough, they kind of fit along the lines of the archetypes that we just talked about with Superman and with General Zod, because you have two very prominent figures, two very popular prominent characters from Hasbro's line that have been given their own miniseries. Again, you know, if they do really well, I'm sure they'll be extended or something, or create, you know, additional volumes. But that is Cobra Commander and Duke. So G.I. Joe and, you know, Cobra Commander for Cobra. So Duke was released first. This is all part of, this is all interconnected with the new Energon universe.
I'm very sorry. I just got shocked because I could have sworn Joshua Williamson was a DC exclusive.
Nope.
Guess not. Okay.
Well, is it one of those things where somebody is a DC or Marvel exclusive, but they can work for indies? Because that happens a lot.
It could be.
I mean, they kind of like the, I think after they shelled too much money out for Bendis, I think I think that, you know, the big two are both gun shy about that.
Yeah.
I do know Hickman is an exclusive apart from indie to Marvel. But it's not nearly as prominent as you once saw it.
Right.
Not nearly. Yeah. I mean, even Dan Slott, who's Marvel to the core, is working on some properties outside. You know, that,
and I bet that's something that's just baked into their contracts. I mean, it's like, we'll offer you an exclusive
at the same time,
mostly so that you're not.
Thing, yeah, another thing, huge thing was, you know, a big appeal to that exclusivity was health insurance, and now that, you know, there are exchanges, you know, depending on what state you live in, the quality that you'll see that's changed a lot of. I mean, not just comics naturally, but just freelance work, period.
And in this case, I mean, it's still independent. I mean, it's Image, but it's Skybound, and you know, not one of the big two. So I think
it's Hasbro.
It's Hasbro, but it's Hasbro's licensed, and, you know. But right. Anyway,
let's get over that. Let's just talk about it. I'm sorry for the.
Let's just talk about it.
I'm sorry. I was just very surprised at the name that was on there. So.
No worries. And actually, it's Joshua Williamson who's writing both of these minis. The artist on Duke is Tom Riley. For Cobra Commander, it's Andrea Milana. And they have very, very different styles, for one. I think what's interesting with Duke is that it's very it's very war comic, very heavy inks. You know, you're looking at a lot of, like, explosions, a lot of, like, you know, monochromatic panels that are one color or just like a couple colors and lots of, you know, lots of blacks, lots of you know, shadows. Whereas in Cobra Commander, you know, there's a lot of shockingly bright colors, really interesting palettes that are being worked with there. So, you know, in the how it's being presented is very interesting because they're very different. But obviously this takes place in the Energon universe, and it takes place, both of these are taking place somewhere around the arrival of the Transformers on Earth. So Duke picks up right after after basically Starscream kind of goes on his rampage in issue 2 or 3 of the Transformers. And there's a couple fighter jets that are scrambled when he shows up. And one of those jets is smashed. And it happens to be with Duke. You know, one of Duke's squad mates, who does not fare very well with Starscream, who grabs him and makes a squishy noise as he destroys him. But Duke, of course, traumatized by this, decides that he is done with, you know, the military. And on top of that, the military is more or less done with him because they have classified the existence of Transformers. They don't want him talking about it, and he won't let it go. So out he goes. He does find, however, a group of people who believe him. You know, mostly a bunch of, you know, kind of fringe theorists and whatnot. But one scientist in particular, you know, brings him in and says, hey, you know, I was working on this really important project, and somehow, like, all my work was stripped away from me. I had nothing except for this. And it looks like, you know, we're working on a new weapons platform. There's something that's coming up, some kind of technology that we really, you know, that we really don't really like because it could be extremely dangerous for all of us. And Duke, of course, you know, wants to figure out more information, wants to know more. So he goes in, he infiltrates this Mars Corporation, which of course is run by Destro, and is let go, but of course with a warning. Everybody seems to know who he is, there could be some very kind of nefarious things going on with the American military as well. that we're not really too sure about. But I mean, here we've got some reveals. We've got some, you know, there's a direct connection to the Transformers, not just the technology, but also the idea of Energon, because Earth has Energon. So this is all kind of leading to potentially where Duke is going to become involved in what becomes G.I. Joe. Cobra Commander, on the other hand, is a very different feel, because this one focuses on Cobra La, which, of course, if anybody is a fan of the original cartoons or the original movie for G.I. Joe back, the, you know, the animated movie back in the 80s, Cobra La is this mythical sort of Shangri-La kind of look, you know, land that's much more developed, that the people kind of are alien-ish. And it's a hidden society somewhere within the bowels of the earth. Well, Cobra Commander has been experimenting. He is a scientist, and he's been experimenting on some strange new technology that is even far beyond what Cobra La has developed over time. And Cobra La, interestingly enough, is being presented as a peaceful society, one that does not abide by the development of weapons. But Cobra Commander's got he's got ambitions. And the Emperor, of course, is kind of, you know, happy to have him explore that, and so sends him out into the world, you know, into normal above ground Earth society to collect more technology, to gather allies, and to, you know, again, for the advancement of Cobra La. Interestingly enough, we also have the reveal of a missing Transformer, an extremely important Transformer that has been, you know, alluded to in the main title. Turns out that Cobra Commander has captured somehow Megatron and has been basically milking Megatron. Maybe milking's not the right word. Using him to build this new technology and to sort of take, you know, Energon particles and use that for his, you know, technological developments and research. So it's really interesting how Hasbro has sort of given this over to Skybound to really integrate these properties. And they're doing it in a great way. Like Josh Williamson here, you know, with these two very different characters, you know, really understands how to present a truly heroic person and a truly despicable person that both have the best interests of their societies in mind. Cobra Commander, glory to Cobra La. We're going to really, you know, we're going to be number one. There's no way that we'll ever be beaten if we can figure out a way to harness all this Energon and harness the technology from these Transformer creatures. And then Duke as well, kind of from the other side. There's, you know, these are too dangerous. This is too much, too destructive. The potential is, you know, too problematic. We can't have people with this amount of power. And obviously they're going to meet, you know, in very explosive ways. But this sort of building into, you know, understanding the histories, their origins in this new universe, this new connected universe that Skybound is putting out, I think Josh Williamson does a really great job here. Beautiful books, really, really interesting, very different art styles, but, you know, are kind of, you know, married thematically as well as, you know, the same writer. So you get that kind of through line. I really like this, and I'm excited to see where they take it, and how this is going to all, you know, connect and, you know, marry up with the main Transformers title. So I don't know if you guys have been, you know, following too much of the Energon universe stuff.
But just Void Rivals number one. I was thinking of getting some trades. I was thinking,
yeah, Void Rivals is great. I love Void Rivals because, you know, other than that first issue reveal, and a couple other issues, obviously a couple of the characters that have been showing up here and there, it's a very unique, it's very much its own story.
Yeah,
and
because I have to say, like, I was really impressed on the outset when IDW had the Revolution arc, which, you know, was the, probably the, you know, the best marriage of the Hasbro, the different Hasbro properties to that point, kind of petered out fairly quickly. But I do like the notion of these characters interacting with each other and it being their own universe. And I just might have to go the trade route because it just,
there's a lot. And I have not read the new G.I. Joe series. I think it started with sort of like the legacy numbering 301.
Yeah.
302 comes out this month. I haven't picked those up yet because I'm really more interested in sort of like the other titles around it. And you know, this will feed in, obviously, you know, Cobra Commander and Duke are going to feed into the G.I. Joe title, but I kind of want to wait. I want to read their stories first. I want to read the Transformers story first before going back. That one I'm probably going to read in trades.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, you've also at this point for both of them, you have almost 40 years for each to mine their history and adapt it in new ways. So,
and these make canon make sense.
And also, these are much bigger name creators than were at IDW. No disparity.
Yeah.
No. I'm not meaning to disparage anybody that worked on those, but you know, this is Skybound. You know, this is these are marks.
And with that comes artists like Daniel Warren Johnson and stuff that are playing with these things. Like you're getting top tier artists right now. I mean, and Tom Riley's not to that point, but Tom Riley's an amazing artist. Like he really is. I love seeing him on these type of books, and he has that very kind of toyetic style. That works just really well.
Yeah. I mean, like the last issue of Transformers. I mean, it's just, I mean, DWJ on this book, so exciting. I just have been really impressed with the stories that they've been telling. You know, Void Rivals is great. It's really cool sci-fi sort of Enemy Mine meets, maybe meets the Matrix a little bit. It's really, really fantastic storytelling. So, I'm just really, I'm happy that Image and that Skybound has these properties because they're doing some great things with it. I mean, we're still in the early days here. So pretty excited to see where it goes.
It's the Matrix, but with robots and Reagan is soldiers.
It's exactly like the Matrix, except different. It's like Lawnmower Man meets the Matrix.
Yeah.
Meets,
it's like the Matrix in 1983.
Yeah.
It's like the Matrix as new Coke. I will stop.
Like to return the mental image that Steve gave us a minute ago about the milking of Megatron. I don't want that in my brain anymore. Can you take that back?
It's you milk them just like cats.
Just
milking the Energon.
We've already talked about fingering. We've already talked about milking, and twice we've referenced libertarianism. Got to stop.
Yeah.
Okay.
We've taken a wrong turn.
Yeah, I believe Caleb has another book. So.
Yeah. So I'll go ahead and just real short. So I've been doing a new thing. We talked about this a little bit last year, where I'm letting books build up and then reading entire books or arcs in the same one. And I did that with this titles as well. This is Killer Queens Volume 2 by Dark Horse Comics. From Dark Horse Comics. It is written by David Boer, drawn by Bradley Clayton with Harry Saxon on the colors and a friend of the show, Louis Gattoni, on the letters.
Question. Was this the same creative team as the first volume?
I think so. I'd have to double check on the colors and stuff, but David Boer absolutely did the writing. I'm pretty sure it was Bradley Clayton. I could be wrong about that, but Louis Gattoni was the letterer on the other one. Different artist. Yeah. David says it's a different artist. So, that makes sense. Like I said, it's been a little bit since I read that other one. I had to go back and check, but, this is fun, right? I love this book. It is lighthearted. It is quirky. It is queer as all hell. This is a sci-fi space super queer adventure, right? You met the two main characters in the first volume. They are just besties, right? They're assassins. They travel the universe and do things. They got themselves in a little bit of trouble with some owing some folks money. And so you see a little bit of that play back into this one. But long story short on this one, they, are, you know, doing their thing. They get into a little bit of a scrape. And they're at a Galactic Pride, which I kind of get depressed at the idea of a Galactic Pride. I would like to think that maybe Earth is the only place that Pride is necessary, but it's not. And so there's a whole planet Pride, right? Like that they're adding at, just doing Pride things. They stumble upon a little bit of drama, right? They get into a little bit of scraping, and one of the main characters' history comes back and injects themselves into our life. You see on the cover, you see one of the main characters. She is full of snark, vim, and vigor. She's definitely one of the better assassins of the two. And she's just, you know, she doesn't talk about her personal life, except apparently she has a sibling and a whole past that involves being a member of a royal family of a planet. Her father is extremely... bigoted to a number of degrees. And so that comes back and they have to figure out a way to work on that when her sibling, who, by the way, is a kind of a non-binary winged individual, crashes their party and has to get like there's a whole rescue sequence and stuff. Again, it's super fun, right? This is just some fun, quirky sci-fi. It is a rescue adventure. It deals with family stuff. It's super queer. There's a monkey with rocket packs with bear bodyguards, and I mean actual bear bodyguards, but in bear, like us bear harnesses. It's fun stuff. So go check this out. I really, really enjoyed it. Just a fantastic sci-fi, again, hyper queer romp.
Well, David says here, Caleb, it's your turn to have a little Freudian moment. So, you know, whenever you want to do that, I mean, we can
I'll work on that.
Yeah. Work on that. And then also, James here, the Emperor's been milking Megatron. Now that's a comic I'd read in a heartbeat. Yeah, I'd be a different audience, I would think. Then, well, maybe this is the right audience for that. Fan fiction people.
I'll show you one of my favorite spreads from this book, though. First issue, at Pride Planet. We've all done things at Pride we regret, right? Like that's a thing. Like. Okay, maybe it's just
overpaying for food, I guess, from a vendor. Maybe?
Well, there's a variety of things.
I regret nothing. I'm glad there aren't pictures, but I regret nothing.
Well, one of our main heroes, he decides he's going to get a Pride tattoo, and I don't know if you can see this. He gets a, you know, for lack of a better way to say it, he gets a tramp stamp of a unicorn pooping rainbows, and the caption is nothing says I'm a top like a unicorn pooping rainbows. It's great.
Yeah. I agree with every sentence. I did read the first. So I read the first volume. I really liked it. It was kind of hard. Cause I had to like, you know, jump from shop to shop to kind of collect the issues. Because of course I didn't reserve them at my LCS, yeah. And so it was kind of like whoever had them still on their shelf, like I was picking them off.
Yeah.
But yeah,
I
the same
definitely
thing.
Definitely have
with
the first
two.
Issue of the first volume. I wasn't even aware there was a second volume.
Yeah, I saw it came out like too late actually put it on my on my full box. So.
Second volume just wrapped up, four issues. They left it open where there can be a third. Like I said, this one deals more so with family than the first one, though. And so I appreciate that, man. Really? And I like the way there were battle axes involved. That's cool.
Definitely cool.
All right. Well, I guess we're going to wrap this episode up. So we're going to go right on to something we call the woofs of the week in the bear community. If you find a fella attractive, you woof at him. And we do something very similar where we woof at something, which may be a comic book, but it may also be a film or a TV program or a charitable initiative, anything under the sun that we think you, fair listener or viewer, may be interested in sampling. I'll start as I always do with Steve. Steve, what is your woof of the week?
Well, my woof of the week is, of course, TV related. And I was kind of going back and forth because there have been two shows that I've absolutely been loving since I came back from vacation. One of them is a nightly late night show after midnight. So I recommend that. But the one that I really want to talk about is Death is in the Details. Right here, a beautiful Hulu series. It's only four parts. At least that's what I'm But I'm understanding that it's only going to be a four-part miniseries. But basically, it features Mandy Patinkin as a washed-up private investigator, detective, who has a connection to the other main character played by Violet Bean, who is a ward of an extremely wealthy corporate family. And they all sort of meet up, on this cruise ship. And there's a murder, and just the twists, the turns, who's really at fault, who's trustworthy, who's gonna, be hiding a lot more stuff than just the murder. It all sort of comes out. It's a great mystery. If you are fans of anything like The Glass Onion or, anything from Rian Johnson, if you're a fan of that, this has very similar Rian Johnson vibes. And it's also got a lot of humor in it, too. So you do have a lot of those sort of fun, punchy conversations that happen, some really great reveals, and just a really good cast. I've got my, my permacrush, Raul Coley is in here as well as the architect of this cruise ship, but also a suspect, potentially, just being handsome and debonair and awesome. But yeah, I totally recommend this if you want to give it a shot. It is on Hulu. It is a weekly episode, a weekly series with new episodes on Tuesdays. The third episode was just released this week. The last episode is next week, which I believe is the 30th of January.
Yeah. Post-iZombie, Rahul's really had a pretty good afterlife there in terms of streaming shows. Some really big projects he's been involved in.
The Fall of the House of Usher, I mean, his role in that, I mean, he was absolutely despicable, but also it kind of was like, can I like...
Right, yeah, no, I was with you, yeah.
Oh, Raul.
All right. Over to Caleb. Caleb, what is your Wolf of the Week?
So, like Steve, my Wolf of the Week also goes out to a television show that is on streaming, but I'm going to go for a different service. This one is on Netflix, and the show that I have been really, really enjoying right now is called Louder Milk. Again, you can find this all up and in the Netflix. In this show, the actor Ron Livingston, if you're not familiar with him, he is fantastic. He was in The Conjuring. He's been on Office Space back in the 90s. He's been in a bunch of stuff, right? He's really good. I think he was actually in the Flash movie too, but I don't remember that. I try not to remember much about that. Anyway.
He's been in a lot, yeah.
Yeah, dude's been doing work. So he plays a bit of a curmudgeon. He is a recovering alcoholic whose job, not really his job. He has just a day job to pay the bills, but kind of what this centers on is the fact that he leads a recovery group. And he's a curmudgeon. He's a cynical asshole. And that's just kind of how he's known, because he's been through a lot. And in this movie, like, of course, not this movie, this show, the chaos really comes when the church or the parish, I should say, that he hosts his meetings in, the parishioner comes up and is like, hey, one of our members needs to talk to you. Her daughter strung out on heroin and you've got to go fix it. Or you're going to lose your spot here. So he goes and he does his thing, introduces him in a most cynical kind of way. And it all kind of blows up from there, but it ends up kind of working and she ends up like crashing with him. It is amazing. The dialogue in this is great. Like, it is very hard to deliver this kind of just like deadpan cynicism in the most sarcastic way possible. He's fantastic. I personally happen to think Ron Livingston is a very attractive man. So I enjoy watching him in this. It's nice. But life comes at you fast, right? Like it's chipping the ice away a little bit. He's built up these walls around him. You get to know some of his story, his past. He was a music journalist, right? Like he worked for people like Rolling Stones and stuff like that, wrote several books and followed bands around and got to see him do all the shenanigans and got to be a part of it. Just played part of his alcoholism. Bill, you would love this. There are tons of quirky little moments in this where they're talking about music history, right? Cool. All through the 80s and 90s, it's in early 2000s. In the show, he writes a book, something about the 500 songs to kill yourself to, right? It's actually about the 500 worst songs of that, but it is hilarious. But again, the girl kind of starts chipping away. He meets a neighbor that he's attracted to. But for me, the best part of this is actually Will Sasso. Will Sasso is a great supporting actor. He is in this. He plays Loudermilk's roommate. And also, he is Loudermilk's sponsor. He's also a recovering alcoholic. Does an amazing job, right? Like, this is probably one of the better roles that I've seen Will Sasso in. And he's been in a lot of cool roles. It is delightful. It really is. Well, I should say Will Sasso is delightful. The show in and of itself is not necessarily delightful, but it is hilarious in the most dark kind of humor ways. The guy pulls no punches. He will just, you know, drop it on you. It is fantastic. So go check this out.
Yeah, go ahead, Steve.
Oh yeah, I just want to say, like, I know this started on another streaming service before it got picked up by Netflix, but I think I want to say the third season might have been produced by Netflix. I'm not 100%, but I do know it started somewhere else and then got acquired.
Yeah, I just discovered this, so I'm it's all on Netflix for me.
Yeah.
Awesome. It's not a show I watch, but how long has Sasso been on Young Sheldon?
According to IMDb, he played on Young Sheldon in 22 and 23.
Okay.
That's what he's credited on IMDb. It was only
the other day that I saw that he was a character on that.
He was also in Marvelous Miss Maisel, which was amazing. Yeah. It was great. I loved him in that.
Yeah, both Steve and I end up watching that terrible sitcom United We Fall. Yep. I love him as a screen presence.
Yeah.
He's a great comedic supporting actor, right? Yeah. Like, I mean, even if you go back to his, what was it, Mad TV stuff, like, he's good. Mm-hmm.
To me, I first saw him in Drop Dead Gorgeous, and
yeah,
I was hooked just from his touching portrayal, and plagued by, you know, disability, but, you know, truly coming into his own.
All right, well, for my Woof of the Week, I'm going against the grain from you two. I actually have something that is comic book related, but it is also a viewing pleasure. So, Steve, I know you have the graphic, but I can also put this up here. This came out this week, 2 days ago. Justice League Crisis on Infinite Earths, Part 1. Yes, they are still making DC original animated movies. Apparently, they still turn enough of a profit that it makes sense for them. It's still viable. And God knows Warner's would cut it off at the knees if it wasn't. So the current predominant theme in the animated universe films that they have right now is something called the Tomorrowverse, which started with Superman, Man of Tomorrow. This is actually the conclusion of the Tomorrowverse as we move into the Peter Safran, James Gunn period of the DC universe. So they are putting the Tomorrowverse to bed, but they're putting it to bed in style with an adaptation of Crisis on Infinite Earths. This is somewhat of a premature woof because I only got it today. It's still in the wrapping, but I'm almost certain I am going to enjoy elements of this, if not the whole thing. It's been a long time that they've had this program going, the animated universe again. You know, the conceit in the past was, you know, direct to video, and it still is, you know, basically direct to video. It just might be that you're buying it through a streaming service or through Amazon or one of those things instead of actually getting home video. But you know me, I gotta have the home video. Interesting thing about what's after this, though, is these films are going to continue. The only one that's been officially announced has been Watchmen. There was a Variety ad for voice talent, and it was pretty clear that the project that they were advertising for was the new Teen Titans, the Judas Contract. Mm-hmm. So Watchmen is happening. These are going to be standalone films, and apparently one of the big selling points is the art styles are going to be as close as they can manage from the original books to animation.
Really?
So the thought of having a Perez and Wolfman contract, like to say I'm there is an understatement. But I think that's a great way of continuing these, not necessarily being worried about the continuity. I imagine they'll come out under the Elseworlds title, that they're going to be putting on things that are not necessarily within that DC universe construct that James Gunn is overseeing. This is the first of three, so it's going to be pretty monumental in terms of the amount of time. I mean, this is, I believe, 2 hours. So a 6-hour Crisis on Infinite Earths, I'm okay with that. I really am. So that's my Wolf of the Week.
There goes Bill Saturdays for the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, absolutely. I did want to mention too, also, I think I can't recall, but I think in my head I was saying Death is in the Details. Death and Other Details is the name of the show. I don't know why I was thinking Death is in. Anyway, just want to correct that. But yeah, I have absolutely loved all the animated movies from the DCAU that came before this one that ended with, I think it was like the Apocalypse War. That whole thing with
Which was like kind of DC 52 was kind of new.
I love that. I thought that was so good. There's been some other standalones.
Voice talent on those were great. The voice
100%.
Oh, man, that was 100%. The voice talent was just like right on the money.
On those. Yeah, and the Tomorrowverse I've really enjoyed too. Like the Man of Tomorrow was so good. It was so good.
I really enjoyed Justice Society. I know a lot of people didn't. I know that Legion of Superheroes was very divisive.
I don't know why.
The Long Halloween seems to be, it seems most people, had a lot of good things to say about the Long Halloween. Good stuff.
The Death in the Family wasn't a part of that, was it? Because I think that was the one that got the most just like chagrin, like that was just lambasted the most.
No, well, that was a scandal.
That would have been the Killing Joke when they tried to
The Killing Joke. Yeah,
maybe that's what I'm thinking of. Maybe I'm thinking of the Killing Joke.
Yeah, because if you did the Killing Joke animated, it's like 32 minutes long, and they had all this barber stuff, and it really
you got a naked Jim Gordon.
In a collar, in a leather collar, leather instead of collar. That's a plus.
That was a plus.
Also, just before we go, I wanted to wish a very happy 50th birthday to friend of the show and former guest Brad Taylor of Warner Brothers. He celebrated his 50th. He did something really cool. He and friends and relations went to Disneyland and they tried to do 50 attractions. They got to 30, but they tried to do 50 in one day. So hats off to that for even managing 30.
They're moving.
I would have been bitching about
especially with lines and that can be tough.
But awesome. Happy birthday to him. So we're wrapping this up again. We are the Comic Book Bears Podcast. You can find us on this went to thing. I even was prepped this time because I had the old intro. You can find us on the Instagram and the X and the Blue Sky and Threads as Comic Book Bears. You can find us on the Facebook as Comic Book Bears Podcast. If you want to listen to us, you can do so through Apple Podcasts, Amazon Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, and from other podcatching platforms. If you want to write to us, please do so by sending an email to Comic Book Bears. If you have joined us through Facebook Live, thank you. If you are watching us later on YouTube, thank you. Please like and subscribe. Until next time, I'm Billy Z.
I'm Steve Morey.
And I'm Caleb Alexander McKenzie.
If you're listening to the audio version, you're going to hear a woof and an explosion. Take care, everyone.
1, 2, standing by.